The Phantom Rickshaw. May no ill dreams disturb my rest, nor powers of darkness me molest. Evening Hymn. One of the few advantages that India has over England is a great knowability. After 5 years' service, a man is directly or indirectly acquainted with the 200 or 300 civilians in his province, all the messes of 10 or 12 regiments and batteries, and some 1,500 other people of a non-official caste. In 10 years, his knowledge should be doubled, and at the end of 20, he knows, or knows something about, every Englishman in the empire, and may travel anywhere and everywhere without paying hotel bills. Globetrotters, who expect entertainment as a right, have, even within my memory, blunted this open-heartedness, but nonetheless today, if you belong to the inner circle and are neither a bear nor a black sheep, all houses are open to you, and our small world is very, very kind and helpful. Rickett of Camartha stayed with Polder of Cumeon some 15 years ago. He meant to stay 2 nights, but was knocked down by rheumatic fever, and for 6 weeks disorganized Polder's establishment, stopped Polder's work, and nearly died in Polder's bedroom. Polder behaves as though he had been placed under eternal obligation by Rickett, and yearly sends the little Ricketts a box of presents and toys. It is the same everywhere. The men who do not take the trouble to conceal from you their opinion that you are an incompetent ass, and the women who blacken your character and misunderstand your wife's amusements, will work themselves to the bone in your behalf if you fall sick or into serious trouble. Heatherly the doctor kept, in addition to his regular practice, a hospital on his private account, an arrangement of loose boxes for incurables, his friend called it, but it was really a sort of fitting-up shed for craft that had been damaged by stress of weather. The weather in India is often sultry, and since the tale of bricks is always a fixed quantity, and the only liberty allowed is permission to work overtime and get no thanks, men occasionally break down and become as mixed as the metaphors in this sentence. Heatherly is the dearest doctor that ever was, and his invariable prescription to all his patients is, lie low, go slow, and keep cool. He says that more men are killed by overwork than the importance of this world justifies. He maintains that overwork slew Pansay, who died under his hands about 3 years ago. He has, of course, the right to speak authoritatively, and he laughs at my theory that there was a crack in Pansy's head, and a little bit of the dark world came through and pressed him to death.
"Pansay went off the handle," says Heatherly, "after the stimulus of long leave at home. He may or he may not have behaved like a blackguard, Mrs. Keith-Wessington. My notion is that the work of the Katabundi settlement ran him off his legs, and that he took to brooding and making much of an ordinary P&O flirtation. He certainly was engaged to Miss Mannering, and she certainly broke off the engagement. Then he took a feverish chill, and all that nonsense about ghosts developed. Overwork started his illness, kept it alight, and killed him, poor devil. Ride him off to the system. One man to take the work of 2.5 men."
I do not believe this. I used to sit up with Pansay sometimes when Heatherly was called out to patients, and I happened to be within claim. The man would make me most unhappy by describing, in a low, even voice, the procession that was always passing at the bottom of his bed. He had a sick man's command of language. When he recovered, I suggested that he should write out the whole affair from beginning to end, knowing that ink might assist him to ease his mind. When little boys have learned a new bad word, they are never happy till they have chalked it up on a door, and this also is literature. He was in a high fever while he was writing, and the Blood and Thunder magazine diction he adopted did not calm him. 2 months afterward, he was reported fit for duty, but in spite of the fact that he was urgently needed to help an undermanned commission stagger through a deficit, He preferred to die, vowing at the last that he was hag-ridden. I got his manuscript before he died, and this is his version of the affair, dated 1885. My doctor tells me that I need rest and change of air. It is not improbable that I shall get both ere long. Rest that neither the red-coated messenger nor the midday gun can break, and change of air far beyond that which any homeward-bound steamer can give me. In the meantime, I am resolved to stay where I am, and in flat defiance of my doctor's orders, to take all the world into my confidence. You shall learn for yourselves the precise nature of my malady, and shall too judge for yourselves whether any man born of woman on this weary earth was ever so tormented as I.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.